Preparation, they say, is the key to success. And in this video, where I tested intake manifolds and cylinder heads on a small block Ford, lack of preparation came back to bite me. In this video, I've got some cool tests run on a pair of different 302 Ford motors. I've got intake manifold tests where we ran four different intakes. We ran two dual plane and two single plane intakes. And on the other test motor, I ran three different cylinder heads. The stock head, GT40P head, you know, the kind you'd get from a wrecking yard from an Explorer, and an aftermarket head, in this case one from Airflow Research, to show the difference. And actually, the lack of preparation didn't come from the dyno tests. The lack of preparation came from the video production. Unfortunately, I went like, got fully excited and said, hey, look, these tests are awesome. I'm going to get to show all the changes in the power curves from the different intake styles and the different cylinder heads. And if a guy were to go to the wrecking yard and this is how much power he would get. And I got all excited and it was really cool stuff. And I went full speed into talking to you guys about the dyno results. Then after that, I thought, okay, now I need to get the photos associated with these tests so I can complete the video. Except a lot of photos weren't there. So I went full speed in doing this without doing the prep work ahead of time, which means I got to bring you this stuff, possibly with some missing photos. So that's just lack of preparation on my part before I jump full speed into the dyno results, which really is the cool stuff and the stuff that I care about, and hopefully you guys care about it too. But I don't like doing that, but I got so excited about doing it, I went full speed and did it anyway. So I'm going to try to fill this in with a couple of photos, but let's get to those dyno results.
First test is to illustrate what happens when you upgrade the cylinder heads on a 5-liter Ford. Now, this is a test they did way back for the guys at Muscle Mustangs and Fast Ford. So a shout out to Jim Campisano and Evan Smith. Those guys are awesome. This is a test I ran on a, yeah, it's kind of a 5-liter Ford. It's actually 306 cubic inches, and it had a forged piston, a forged flat top piston with valve relief, so that we could run a little bit of camshaft in it without any problem. And I ran a ton of cylinder heads. As a matter of fact, I had to build four different test motors, and I ran about 30 sets of heads. And in addition to building those motors and running them all in the dyno, I actually airflow tested all of those heads. I measured all of the intake and exhaust port volumes, all the chamber volumes. I even measured all of the spring packages and even went to the trouble of weighing all the springs. That's right, I did spring mass on it. So I'll be doing a big thing on that later on. But this is a test to show two things. One, what would happen if you went down to the wrecking yard and wanted to upgrade your heads the way a lot of us do and get the Ford Explorer stuff? So if you got a set of GT40 heads or the GT40P heads, both of those were available in the Explorer depending on the year. So if you upgraded that from, you know, if you put that in place of a stock head, what could you get? And then how much more could you get with, let's say, a really good aftermarket head? So that's what I want to show here. So this test motor, 30 over, forged flat top pistons, had an Extreme Energy 264 cam and not my usual 274 cam. I'll go ahead and put the specs up there for the camshaft. It's a fairly mild one, good street cam, works really well. We also had a Performer RPM air gap intake and a 650 Demon carburetor, so more than enough carburation. Typical kind of 1¾-inch Fox chassis hooker headers, MSD distributor, you know, kind of the way that we did it back in the day. So equipped with our stock E7TE heads, the only thing we did on this head was upgrade the valve springs. And as we'll see, that's a very important option. So equipped as such, our 306-inch small block Ford produced 306 horsepower, right at 1 horsepower per cubic inch, the magic number. 306 horsepower and 342 foot-pounds of torque with the stock head. So now let's take a look and see what happened when we installed the GT40P heads. And this is what would happen if you went to the wrecking yard and grabbed a set of P heads and put them on your and replaced your stock E7TE heads. And right off the bat, you have to be going, wow, that's the maybe one of the ugliest curves I've ever seen. And I can tell you what was going on, not just with these heads, but with all of the heads except for the stock heads, because I upgraded the valve springs on the stock heads. And this is a problem I ran into when running this test. And you can imagine if you multiply this by 30, the kind of issues that I had, although in honesty, a lot of them didn't have valve spring problems, but these did. These had a valve spring issue. And what I wanted to do was I had to decide when I was doing this test, do I want to run the heads the way that they're supplied, the way that the average guy would get them, or do I want to go through the trouble and upgrade all the valve springs, like you should, especially when you're running an extreme energy cam, which is a fairly aggressive profile. So what we ran into was definitely valve fluid. I mean, you could see here at 5,900, the power just fell off, and that's definitely a valve control problem. And we're even seeing it in the middle here. So with those P heads, and I think that we were already at the power peak with this combination anyway, it made 336 horsepower, so we definitely picked up power compared to the stock head. So we picked up 30 horsepower, which is kind of typical in what we would expect from a P-head upgrade. And peak torque was up to 358 foot-pounds of torque. So that's a good upgrade. It's cheap. You can go get them at the junkyard. You know, as a matter of fact, if I was doing it, I probably wouldn't just go get the heads. I'd just go get the whole Explorer motor and run that. And if you want to run it carbureted, just buy the long block, strip the EFI stuff off of it, and just run a carburetor. If you're going to run an EFI, keep the GT40 stuff. It works really well. So here's what happened when we put a set of aftermarket heads on it. And these were Airflow Research 165 heads. There's a lot of other good heads out there. We had run Canfield's. Brodix has got good stuff. Edelbrock has good stuff. Trickflow obviously has good stuff. There's a lot of good stuff out there for this, for a small block Ford. But here's what happened when we put the 165s on. We have a big jump in power. But again, if you look at this, this thing made peak power at 5,800 RPM and then fell off fairly rapidly thereafter. And this is one thing I went over with the guys from Airflow Research way back when we did this test. I told them, look, I ran into this with all of the heads. All of the heads, and I should note that since then, a lot of this has been rectified. But back then, a lot of the heads that were supplied did not have enough valve spring. And I don't know if that's because the guys were going conservative on the valve spring. These were all designed for hydraulic roller cams and not for flat tappet cams, which would be another reason why we wouldn't have enough valve spring. But these are all hydraulic roller deals. I just think that these guys went soft on the spring to make sure that they didn't hurt camshafts or whatever the reason was. So let me know in the comments. Let me know what you guys think. But upgrading the spring would definitely improve the power output out at the top. The Airflow Research made 396 horsepower and torque was up to 378 foot-pounds. So it was doing well and it also didn't lose any power. I think that the Airflow Research head, and I'll go ahead and put the specs up here, might have also had a slightly smaller chamber than the P head and also then maybe the socket. But here are the gains offered by the two different kinds of heads, like the junkyard deal and then a good aftermarket head. You can see they're worth quite a bit, even on a fairly mild application. Let's check out the intake testing next. This test was designed to illustrate the difference in intake manifolds. We tested four different Edelbrock intake manifolds for a small block Ford, starting with the RPM 289, which is essentially, it's listed as a replacement intake for factory manifold. So if you're replacing a factory 289 or a 302 intake manifold, that's a really good one. The next one was an RPM air gap, which is an even more powerful version. It's kind of the go-to intake if you have a performance application, assuming that you have enough hood clearance. Now, the next two were single plane intakes. The first one was a Torquer 2, and that works well, especially if you're a hood clearance challenged. But it's a single plane, so it's designed for high RPM. And the same thing with the last of the four intakes. That's the Edelbrock Victor Jr. And like the RPM air gap, the Victor Jr. is kind of the go-to intake for single plane applications as long as you have enough hood clearance. So we tested all four intake manifolds on the same combination on our same engine combination, which was a flat top 302 with valve reliefs. We had the Extreme Energy 274 HR camshaft, so it was different than the 264 that we used on the cylinder head test that we did previously. So I'll go ahead and put the specs up for the 274 cam. By now, you guys should all know that, but it's a good cam, a good dual-purpose cam, and it works really well for a lot of applications. We also equipped this combination with Airflow Research 185 heads, which work real well even on a 302. I know a lot of guys like the 165 heads, but I've used the 185 heads a lot on 302 base motors and they work really well. And I actually haven't seen them really lose power even way down low compared to the 165. So I always step up to the 185s. 165 also works well. So we ran all four of these intakes with the same 650 carburetor and 1¾-inch long tube hooker headers for a Focke chassis and MSD distributor. We did jetting and timing sweeps on all of them to find out what worked, but as it turned out, the same timing curve worked for all of the intake manifolds. They all kind of seemed to like the same thing. And since this was a distributor, it was basically all in by 3,000 RPM anyway. So here's what happened when we ran the first combination with our Edelbrock RPM 289 intake. This thing produced 404 horsepower and 379 foot-pounds of torque. So here's what happened when we replaced that RPM 289 intake with the RPM air gap. We picked up a fairly good bit of power, maybe lost a touch down here, down below 3,000 RPM, but the peak power jumped up to 427 horsepower, which is a good amount for this kind of combination. Now let's take a look and see what happened when we, and did I give you guys, I think I did give you guys peak torque, 395 foot-pounds of torque, so good torque production there. So here's what happened when we installed the first of our single-plane intakes, and what we would expect from a single-plane, what typically happens is we lose power down low, and we pick up power up at the top. So I'm going to get rid of the RPM air gap, and I'll just show you the difference first between the two intakes. So this is the torquer intake versus the RPM, the standard, the 289 RPM, and as we expected, the torquer, the single plane, lost power down low, down below 4,700 RPM, but picked up power up at the top. It made 427 horsepower. Peak torque was not changed. The peak number was not changed very much, 385 foot-pounds. It just happened out higher in the RPM range, 386 foot-pounds out there at 5,500. And here's how I'm going to show you how this torquer 2 compared to the RPM air gap. The RPM air gap actually made the same peak power as the torquer. The torquer just lost power to the dual plane down low. So if you're choosing between the two and you have the hood clearance, the RPM really is the way to go there. So now let's get back to our performer. We'll get rid of our torquer and we'll get rid of our RPM. Now let's take a look at our last intake, which is the Victor Jr., also a single plane, but made more power than the torquer. So the Victor Jr. made 436 horsepower, so it did well. And peak torque was 391 foot-pounds of torque, and it made less power below 4,500, more power above that, and did pretty well on the top. But honestly, this mild 302 combination is not ideal for any of these single plane intakes. It really should have the RPM air gap, which is kind of the ideal combination for this. But if you are a hood clearance challenge, you have to maybe think about the other intake manifold. So let's see how the Victor Jr. compared to the air gap. The Victor Jr. made more power at the top above 5,400 RPM. Not by much, but by about, I think that the peak was 27 versus 36, so 9 or 10 horsepower, but it lost power down low, so it probably isn't a good trade-off. And like I said, that single plane's not a good choice for this kind of combination. The RPM air gap is kind of the go-to intake for this kind of 400 horsepower mild cam 302. Let's get to our conclusion.
Okay guys, what did you think about my lack of preparation on this video? Make sure to make some comments, guys, because everybody makes mistakes. But I honestly thought that I had all of the photos associated with this, even after losing all of my data and trying to recover everything. I thought that that stuff was there. I know what the photos look like. I remember seeing them. I just could not find them in all of my different areas where I had this stuff, and now I'm bringing it all together. My fault entirely, no problem. Hopefully you guys like the dyno results. It's good stuff. I mean, single plane intake, typical dual stuff, dual plane, single plane stuff, lose power down low, pick power up top. And the cylinder head stuff I really like because it represents what a guy would do if he went to the junkyard and picked up a GT40 or a GT40P head from the Explorer, which is good. And then how much more power there is available from really lots of good heads are available for the 5-liter. Now I'm going to follow this stuff up. I've got the big ultimate cylinder head test that I did for the guys at Muscle Mustangs in multiple parts because there's so many heads, and I'll try to get to that so I can get all that information to my Ford guys. I'm Richard Holder, guys. Thanks for watching. You know the drill. Like, share, subscribe, do all that crazy stuff. Thanks for watching.